Hello. Our guest spot this week is Stephanie Forrest, who is professor of computer science at the University of New Mexico, where she directs the Adaptive Computation Lab. Stephanie is also external professor at the Santa Fe Institute and co-chairs the Institute's Science Board. Steph has been working for many years at the intersection of computer science and biology, and is an expert on genetic algorithms, which we've been studying in this unit. So welcome, Steph.
Thank you so much. It's great to be here.
So I know you've been studying genetic algorithms for a long time. We've even worked together on projects in genetic algorithms. But I wanted to get your view of why genetic algorithms are relevant to the study of complex systems.
Well, the first thing is that genetic algorithms can be viewed as a simple model of Darwinian evolution. So just kind of from a modeling perspective, they capture, you know, one of the most important and mysterious processes on Earth, evolution. The second thing is that this model of Darwinian evolution can also be viewed as a kind of design strategy. And it's a design strategy that's been used widely in nature, but also adapted as a computational algorithm to help design engineering systems. And so genetic algorithms are actually used widely in engineering as well.
So just to follow up, why do you say that evolution is mysterious?
Well, first of all, not everyone, you can't look at it. I think that's the thing. So it's a process that, going back to Darwin, was proposed as an explanation for how the world that we live in came to be. But that's not a process that we can observe, or it's very difficult to study experimentally. There are now some experimental systems that you can study in test tubes, like viruses and bacteria that undergo evolution. And so we can study those experimentally. Mm-hmm. But I think it's when we confront the world around us, to me, it is somewhat of a mystery how the world came to be. And even though I tend to believe that the world was produced by evolution, it's not always so trivial to understand how that might have happened mechanically.
Right.
And I guess I just, one other thing is, another mysterious aspect of evolution are the so-called major transitions, where the system that's evolving undergoes some major organizational shift, and the sort of action, the evolutionary action, takes place at a different organizational level. And I think even today, most people in evolution would not claim that they understand how those shifts take place.
Mm-hmm. So you said that genetic algorithms are a model for evolution. Do you think that they can give us any insight into biological evolution?
I do, yes. How? How, you might ask. I mean, they've been used to model many kinds of naturally occurring evolutionary processes, not just biological, by the way, but in the realm of social sciences, you can think of genetic algorithms as modeling how innovations spread through a community. Mm-hmm. And how, you know, people have written books on the diffusion of innovation, and the idea there is really that ideas and fads spread through populations in a process not unlike Darwinian evolution.
Mm-hmm. So you think Darwinian evolution is a useful idea, not just in biology, but in other fields?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. I would not claim that it's the only idea.
Of course.
I do think it's an important idea, and certainly relevant to the study of most complex systems.
So what are you working on now? So what are you excited about, particularly in the field of genetic algorithms?
So about 10 years ago, I became interested in my own field. I mean, I've always been interested in my own field, but became particularly interested in software and thinking about how software infrastructures, that is large collections of software. For example, all the programs that are sitting on disks of computers that are attached to the internet, how that large collection sort of changes over time and whether or not it is subject to the processes of evolution. And through that, I became interested a little more directly in whether or not it would be possible to evolve software. For example, could we design a program rather than hiring a highly trained programmer to write it? Could we use evolutionary processes to produce programs? And although I can't claim that I've solved that problem exactly, that led me into what is potentially an easier problem, which is using evolution to evolve repairs to software defects or bugs. And so the idea is you give me a buggy program and I make a number of copies, typically 40 copies of that program. And each of those copies has some random mutations, not unlike genetic mutations. And then we use a genetic algorithm to select the members of the population that are the most fit, that is pass, in our case, fitness is measured in terms of regression test suites. And after a few generations, evolution mysteriously produces a program that in many cases repairs the bug.
Wow, that's impressive. Are you gonna put programmers out of work?
Well, potentially. I mean, I do think that software is a huge bottleneck, and software maintenance is a huge bottleneck. So if you look at the economics of computing and where the money's being spent, 90% of the cost of software goes into maintenance, and maintenance is, I mean, most of that is debugging, mm-hmm. fixing problems in software that have been identified. And one study, it's a couple of years old now, but one study estimated the cost of software bugs as being 0.6% of the U.S. GDP.
Wow.
Which is, you know, a significant economic impact. Uh-huh. So even if we don't put all the programmers out of business, I think if we can accelerate their productivity by perhaps either proposing fixes that they can then check and decide if they want to accept, or by taking over the tedious task of fixing small bugs and leaving the programmers to tackle the more interesting and complex bugs, that would be an acceptable outcome.
So how far is this from being a commercial product?
Well, it's quite a ways from being a commercial product. We thought about commercializing it, but so far we've gone the open source public domain route. And so all of our programs are available on our website. I should mention I'm not doing this work by myself. I do it in collaboration with a professor at the University of Virginia who knows much more about software engineering and programming languages than I do. His name is Wesley Weimer. And the two of us have, I think both surprised ourselves at how well this project has gone. And we recently completed a big study of over 150 bugs randomly selected, and we pretty reliably fix just over 50% of them on the first try.
Wow, that is really impressive.
Thank you.
It's better than most people can do.
Better than I can do at this point, which is embarrassing to admit. But
well, you don't need to if you've got your genetic algorithm to do it.
Right. So, how we use it and how we kind of introduce it into mainstream computing is still an open question for us.
So you mentioned this idea of genetic algorithms automatically creating programs, not just debugging them. So I know there's a big field called genetic programming, which is trying to address this. How difficult a problem do you think that is? And we looked at an example in our class of creating a simple program to move a robot around on a screen. and have it do certain actions. But the question is, how hard is this to scale up to really complex programs? Do you think that's going to happen?
I don't think it's going to happen immediately. Mm-hmm. And in fact, I will just point out that the problem that genetic programming addresses is the problem of starting from scratch. Hmm. And one of the reasons that we were able to be as successful as we've been in the bug repair domain is that we're starting with a program that is 99.999% correct. Right? It's correct in all ways, except it has one bug. Mm-hmm. So we're just trying to fix that one bug. And the genetic programming people, you know, start at the other end, and I don't know which end is going to be better in the long run. My theory would be to take what we've done with working programs or partially working programs and kind of looking forward, start thinking about how to add functionality to a program that's already working in part. And maybe that's the difference between evolution and the origin of life. I don't know.
All right. Well, thank you so much. This has been really great.
Oh, you're very welcome. It's fun, and complex systems are wonderful.
Okay. Thank you.